Welcome back, mineralogy fans. It's nice to share, and the more silica tetrahedra there are left in a melt, the more they join together by sharing corners. After making single chains in the pyroxene group, double chains were formed in the amphibole group. Now we begin to share all three basal corners to make sheets. The sheet silicates come in two main flavors, the micas and the clay sheet silicates. Mica comes in many forms but has two main varieties, biotite and muscovite. The word mica means crumbs, and as you can see from our sample boxes, that is an appropriate term for what becomes of this mineral. Biotite is less chemically stable at the surface than muscovite, but both are much more stable than the mafic minerals we just encountered. The micas are common in granitic rocks, and muscovite particularly can survive to end up in many sandstones and siltstones and eventually become clay. The micas also appear in the metamorphic rocks like phyllite, schist, and gneiss. Because the micas are made of silicate sheets bound together by cations like calcium or potassium, they have very characteristic cleavage, that being one direction of cleavage splitting into sheets. This makes this a favorite mineral of my OCD students, and thus one of the samples I have to replace in our lab rooms the most. The most obvious difference between biotite and muscovite is the color, and that is basically how a geologist tells these two apart. Biotite, named after the famed 17th century mineralogist Jean-Baptiste Biot, is a softer mineral with a hardness of 2.5 to 3, so it won't scratch glass. A penny will scratch it, but your fingernail won't. It leaves a colorless to brown streak. It has the undiagnostic 2.7 specific gravity of the most common minerals, and is identified mostly by its dark color and single direction of cleavage, which allows this mineral to grow into what we call books. The more iron in the biotite, the denser and less chemically stable at the surface, and darker it is. The luster is less and less the non-metallic vitreous luster as you put more iron in and approaches what is known as submetallic luster. Because magnesium can swap out for iron in the structure, we get a series going from the more common iron-rich black biotite to magnesium-rich brown to golden-colored phlogopite. Biotite is more often associated with the intermediate to felsic igneous rocks, whereas phlogopite shows up more with olivine, pyroxene, and amphibole mafic rocks. When biotite is hydrothermally altered, it turns to vermiculite, which expands when heated and becomes one of the best thermal insulators known. So we use vermiculite in insulation, but also in potting soil due to its absorptivity. Although all the micas are great thermal insulators, the high iron content of biotite makes it a poor electrical insulator. Phlogopite is a preferred electrical and thermal insulator because it breaks down at the same rate as copper wiring and withstands very high temperatures, even higher than the other end member of the mica group, muscovite. Muscovite is slightly softer than biotite at 2 to 2.5, so you may be able to scratch it with your fingernail, maybe. It has a specific gravity of 2.8 to 3, so no big difference from the main pack there. It is mainly identified by one direction of cleavage and the lighter color than biotite or phlogopite. It is associated with more felsic igneous rocks and appears as the light-colored shiny minerals in metamorphic rocks. Being a lighter and clearer mineral, one of its traditional uses was for window panes. Some of the largest deposits are in India and Russia. The Russian deposits come from the Moscow district that used to be called Muscovy, and the window panes from that area were called Muscovy windows, and so the name muscovite stuck. With the advent of better glass technology, we don't use muscovite for this purpose as much anymore, though some furnace windows still use it. It is also used as the holiday glitter of fake snow, and all the micas get ground up for use as fillers, anticoagulant, roofing material, and even shows up in paints and cosmetics. Because muscovite is rather chemically stable, even though it breaks down into crumbs, it can be a significant component in sandstones and siltstones, but when it gets down to that size, it becomes part of the clays. Clay is a size term, but it is also a mineral group of mostly sheet silicates of very small size. It's a zoo down there with montmorillonite, kaolinite, smectite, illite, lizardite, Santa Feite, cuprous gladauskite, and everyone's favorite coming tonight. The silicate sheets can be put together in various ways, but one of the most dangerous for civil engineers is this. The 2-2-1 structure in which a sandwich of silicate sheets, then cations, silicate sheet is repeated with only weak bonds between the sandwiches. This means that water can get in between the sandwiches and expand them open, and when humidity drops, the water will leave again and add it up in a soil. All this expansion when wet and contraction when dry can cause some real problems for building foundations. Swelling soil causes more infrastructure damage than any other natural hazard, and you should be very aware of where it occurs in your community before you buy a property. Besides these type of clays being a risk, the clays in general, or mud, cover about 80% of the Earth's surface, and thus is a major player in the sedimentary rocks, and the grist for the metamorphic mill. Metamorphism and hydrothermal activity can take these main silicate minerals and create some new and beautiful varieties, a few of which we will meet in our next and last episode on the silicate minerals.